The First Battle of Amman was fought from 27 to the 31st of March 1918 during the First Transjordan attack on Amman of the Sinai and Palestine Campaign of the First World War. The 60th Division and the Anzac Mounted Division attacked the Ottoman garrison at Amman deep in enemy-occupied territory, 48 kilometers from their front line, after capturing Es Salt and Shunet Nimrin. The Egyptian Expeditionary Force was successfully counterattacked by Ottoman Empire forces, forcing them to retreat back to the bridgeheads captured on the Jordan River. Following the victories at the Third Battle of Gaza and the Battle of Beersheba, the EF had pursued the retreating Ottoman armies, fighting successful battles at Mughar Ridge in November and capturing Jerusalem in December. During the winter of 1917-1918, these considerable territorial gains were consolidated and the front line established. In February 1918, the front line was pushed eastwards by the EF when the right flank of the Jaffa to Jerusalem line was extended by the capture of land from the east of Jerusalem stretching down into the Jordan Valley to capture Jericho. In early March, the front line from the Mediterranean to Abu Telul in the Judean Hills was pushed north during the action of Telassa. These two adjustments to the front line were necessary precursors to advances by Allenby's EF across the Jordan River and into the hills of Moab to Es Salt and Amman. The passage of the Jordan was effected by a British Empire force of Australian and British swimmers, crossing the fast-flowing river while under fire. Pontoon bridges were quickly constructed and the infantry and mounted troops crossed the river to establish bridgeheads on the eastern bank, before advancing up to and across the high country, the infantry moving along the main road with the mounted columns riding on both flanks. They were to cut the railway line to the north and south of Amman by destroying long sections of the Hejaz railway, including bridges and a viaduct. Amman was strongly defended by the 4th Army garrison, which was further strengthened by the arrival of reinforcements. British Empire infantry and artillery reinforcements from Es Salt strengthened the 181st Brigade and the Anzac Mounted Division's attacking force travelling across difficult and unfriendly terrain. Although the combined force of infantry and mounted troops made determined attacks on Amman over several days, the strength of defense and threats to lines of communication forced a retreat back to the Jordan Valley. The only territorial gains following the offensive were the establishment of bridgeheads on the eastern side of the river at Gournier and Mekedet Hejla. Chapter 1 – Background. After capturing Aqaba, Prince Faisal's Sherifile forces pushed north after establishing a new base at Aqaba. Raiding parties attacked the Hejaz Railway from Tobruk, and a small train force based in the Wadi Araba in the Gore south of the Dead Sea, threatened Marn and Hish Forest. An Ottoman attack northwest of Marn in the Petra region in October 1917 was partly successful, but did not stop the raids. At the end of 1917, Sherifile forces captured Shobek and Tofila 72 kilometers north of Marn, and in January 1918 wiped out the Ottoman force sent to retake Tafila. In retaliation, Erich von Falkenhayn, commanding Yildirim Army Group, ordered a force to Katrani halfway between Marn and Amman, which included a German battalion, which drove the Sherifile force out of Tafila and back to Shobek in early March. While von Falkenhayn's force, which had been redeployed from the 4th Army in the Amman region, was out of position attacking the Sherifile forces at Tafila, there was an opportunity for the EF to invade the Transjordan and attack Amman. Such an attack would draw von Falkenhayn's force northwards back towards Amman and make it possible for Prince Faisal to attack Marn. It may also be possible for the EF and the Sherifile force to make contact. Before the first Transjordan attack could begin, it was necessary to broaden the EF's base to better support the proposed attack on the Hejaz Railway at Amman. Between 8 and the 12th of March 1918, the front line in the Judean Hills was pushed further north during the Battle of Telassa, resulting in a substantially stronger base for attacks to the east. A general advance on a front of between 23 to 42 kilometers and up to a maximum of depth of between 8 to 11 kilometers by the XX Corps and 21 Corps pushed Ottoman forces north from the River Auja on the Mediterranean coast, from both sides of Jerusalem to Nablus Road, capturing Ras El Ain and Telassa, and from Abu Telul and Masala beyond the heights above the Jordan Valley. Chapter 1, Section 1, Amman. Also called Rabath Ammon by the Ammonites and Philadelphia when it was one of the Decapolis's 10 cities during Roman rule, Amman, with its fine Roman ruins including an amphitheatre, lies cupped in hills. A citadel on a hill covered the northern and western approaches to the city, while east was the Hejaz Railway, turntable and railway station 3 kilometers from the city along the Wadi Amman. To the south of the station was a 10-arched viaduct and a 141-meters railway tunnel. Chapter 2, Prelude. Prior to the advance to Es Salt and Amman, diversionary attacks across the entire front were planned to precede the passage of the Jordan River and the establishment of a bridgehead on the eastern bank. The diversionary attacks were to be coordinated with an Arab raid led to T. Lawrence on the Hejaz railway station at Deraa. This railway line ran from Constantinople to Damascus, continuing southwards through eastern Syria 100 kilometers east of Jerusalem all the way to Medina. Chapter 2, Section 1, Ottoman Forces. The headquarters of the Ottoman 4th, 7th and 8th armies were located at Amman east of the Jordan River, and at Nablus and Tulkarm in the Judean hills respectively. The headquarters of the Yildirim army group commanded by Otto Lehmann von Sanders was located at Nazareth. The Tulkarm garrison was commanded by Yasin al-Hashimi, who also commanded Ottoman troops during the battle. About 4,000 to 5,000 German and Ottoman soldiers with rifles, a large number of machine guns and 15 guns defended fortified positions covering the railway viaduct and tunnel in the Amman area, while another 2,000 Ottoman soldiers defended the region towards Es Salt. The force defending Shunet, Nimrin, Es Salt, and Amman, commanded by Lieutenant Colonel Asim, included the 3rd Assault Company with 3 infantry battalions, the German 703rd Infantry Battalion with the Asia Corps Machine Gun Company, a cavalry troop and an artillery section. The assault detachment was composed of 1 infantry company, 1 engineer platoon and 7 light machine gun teams. The officers assigned to the assault detachments were handpicked from within the division by divisional staff. The assault detachment was given 4 weeks training in German-style stormtrooper tactics, to which the division sent an additional officer and 5 NCOs. Eventually, the assault detachment was expanded into an assault battalion. These assault battalions, which consisted of between 300 and 350 officers and men, were well equipped. They were frequently used in counterattacks and as divisional and corps reserves. The 3rd Assault Company was formed from a divisional detachment in late February 1918. Defending Amman on the 27th of March, the Ottoman and German garrison consisted of 2,150 rifles, 70 machine guns and 10 guns. Jamal Kuchuk, commander of the 4th Army, arrived on the 28th of March to take command of the defense of Amman. Up to the 30th of March, approximately 2,000 reinforcements arrived with more to follow. In reserve at the Amman railway station were the 46th Assault Company from the infantry's 46th Division. Part of the 150th Regiment garrisoned Amman and part of the regiment guarded the railway to the north and south of the city. 1 battalion of this regiment and 1 battalion of the 159th Regiment with some Circassian irregular cavalry guarded the region towards the Jordan River between Es Salt and Gornier, manning posts guarding the river. The German 703rd Battalion with a cavalry troop, an artillery section and the Asia Corps Machine Gun Company, which was particularly strong in machine guns, had arrived back from Tofila and was in the foothills at Shunet Nimrin on the Amman Road by the 21st of March. These units amounted to no more than 1,500 rifles deployed between Amman and the Jordan River when the EF crossed the river. German and Ottoman squadrons of aircraft in the area included single-seater Albatross D.V.AS and A. For example, two-seaters with Rumpler LVG's engines and Halberstadt two-seaters, all with similar flying speeds to the British Bristol fighters. Chapter 2, Section 2, She's Force. The Lieutenant General Philip Chetwode's 20 Corps was given oversight of the invading force under the command of Major General John Shea, commander of the 60th Division. Shea's force consisted of his infantry division, the Anzac Mounted Division, the Imperial Camel Brigade, including their artillery of the Hong Kong and Singapore Mountain Battery, with four BL 2.75-inch mountain guns. They were supported by a light armored car brigade and the 10th Heavy Battery Royal Garrison Artillery. On several occasions during the concentration of Xi's force, German and Ottoman aircraft bombed their camps, which had been left unprotected by British Empire aircraft. Chapter 2, Section 3, Chaytor's Force. Edward Chaytor commanded the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade, the 2nd Light Horse Brigade and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, which advanced to attack Amman from S. Salt. Chapter 2, Section 4, Northern Flank Protection. Two regiments of the 1st Light Horse Brigade were deployed to defend the northern flank of Xi's and Chaytor's forces in the Jordan Valley, with one regiment garrisoning S. Salt. Chapter 2, Section 5, Objectives of Ife Attack. Despite the extended front Xi's force would be operating on far from reinforcements, resistance to the attack was expected to be light. The primary tactical objective of the attack was the destruction of the Amman Viaduct. By destroying railway infrastructure, which would take considerable time to rebuild, like tunnels and viaducts, pressure on the Arab forces operating in the Amman area by the Ottoman army would be reduced. Allende also hoped Xi's attack would encourage the recall of a large Ottoman force which had occupied Tafila in March. The railway was to be destroyed by Chaytor's force, in particular the viaduct. A bridge to the north of the viaduct and another bridge close to the Amman station were the objectives. Subsequent to gaining all objectives, Chaytor and Shay were to withdraw back to the Jordan River, leaving a strong detachment at S. Salt and mounted troops to protect its communication. During these operations, the remainder of the IF continued to hold the front line, garrison the captured territories and transport supplies and rations. Chapter 2, Section 6, Trek to Amman. The 3rd Light Horse Regiment occupied S. Salt in the evening of the 25th of March, with the 179th Brigade of the 60th Division entering the town at midnight. S. Salt was garrisoned by the 60th Division and the 6th Squadron, Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment. While the two brigades of the Anzac Mounted Division, the New Zealand Mounted Rifles and the 2nd Light Horse Brigades with the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade were to climb directly from the Jordan Valley up to the plateau riding towards Amman, following tracks further south through Nawa, concentrated at Anes Crossroads next morning, the 26th of March. Amman, a further 29 kilometres to the east-southeast across the plateau from S. Salt, is 900 metres above sea level, requiring a climb of 290 metres from S. Salt. The divisional headquarters of the Anzac Mounted Division, together with the 2nd Light Horse Brigade and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, marched towards Amman on the No. 3 road, a track well to the south of the main road which passed through the village of Nior, some 5 kilometres to the south of Shunet Nimrin. From the Jordan River at 370 metres below sea level, the road to Nior, 26 kilometers away, rises 1,300 meters through a maze of rocky hills intersected by deep ravines. The head of the mounted force reached the top at about 2 o'clock on the 25th of March, but was stretched out in single file for about 13 kilometers along the side of the mountains. As the road to Nior dwindled away to a track, all wheels had to be left behind, including most of the reserve small arms ammunition. Only four small pack mountain guns, the little reserve ammunition, and the explosives required to demolish the viaduct and tunnels were put on camels and pack horses to make the trek forward. On this trek, near the Wadi El Krin, a group of Arabs joined the light horse units. Chapter 2, Section 7, Pause on the 26th of March. After a second night's march in the cold and wet conditions, moving over both bog and rock, the Anzac Mounted Division concentrated at Ain Essir on the early morning of 26 March, 10 km west of Amman. The weather was atrocious, sleet and heavy rain continued for almost the entire operation, making the roads and tracks soft and boggy. The condition of the roads was not improved when all rations and forage had to be sent up to the advancing troops on camels and pack horses. By this stage, the advance had been on the march continuously for 3 days and nights, and owing to the exhaustion of the men and horses, Chaytor, commander of the mounted division, postponed the attack on Amman until the next morning. During the day, the sun came out to dry sodden clothing and a patrol of 6 German infantry was captured. Another German approaching the lines was shot and a cavalry patrol of 3 men were accounted for. Major General Chaytor advanced with the 2nd Light Horse Brigade 2.4 kilometers to the north along the Ain Hummer track. They saw an enemy column on the assault to Amman Road, which the 5th Light Horse Regiment was instructed to capture. 2 squadrons quickly captured 12 prisoners, 19 motor lorries, 4 cars and a number of carts, some of which were stuck in the mud. The 2nd Light Horse captured prisoners in the village of Suweiler and 30 German lorries were found bogged on the road from Es Salt. 21 of the derelict lorries were destroyed. As soon as it was dark, a special patrol of a troop of the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment set out to cut the railway line to the south of Amman. They rode 16 kilometers there and back in darkness and pouring rain, successfully blowing up a 11 kilometers section of railway line south of Amman. A similar group from the 2nd Light Horse Brigade attempted to wreck the line north of Amman but encountered enemy cavalry in strength and was unsuccessful, although a 2-arched bridge on the railway north of Amman was destroyed. The infantry was also forced to halt on the 26th of March. During the course of the day, 49 prisoners were collected in Es Salt and 90 sick and wounded, including a British soldier, were found in a hospital there. The 180th Brigade was still at Shunet Nimrin, while the 179th Brigade, less the 215th Battalion, London Regiment, which remained at Es Salt, moved back to the Havage Bridge to easy supply. The 181st Brigade formed a flying column of 2 battalions of infantry, 3 mountain gun batteries and the squadron of the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment, with orders to advance to Amman the next day in support of Chaytor's force. Chapter 3, Battle. The terrible conditions which forced a delay on the 26th of March gave the Ottoman forces ample warning to consolidate their defences. Nevertheless, during the battle, small gains were made by the 2 brigades of the Anzac Mounted Division and battalions of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade commanded by Chaytor, as they began to make an impact on the strongly entrenched German and Ottoman forces. Chapter 3, Section 1, the 27th of March. By daylight, Chaytor's force was advancing across the undulating plateau on roads and tracks in a landscape which restricted movement. All off-road movement was virtually impossible because the wet and boggy terrain had recently been ploughed and planted, with first shoots starting to appear. The terrain favoured defence with stones which had been gathered from the fields and piled up in heaps or laid out in lines at the field's edges, providing good cover for concealed enemy riflemen and machine guns. The wadis in the region were steep-sided, making crossing by horses difficult. The Wadi Amman could not be crossed except in one or two places. By 10:30, when the head of the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade had reached Ain Amman 2 kilometers southwest of the city, and the 2nd Light Horse Brigade on the left was within 5 kilometers of Amman railway station, Chaytor ordered the attack. The mounted riflemen were to capture Hill 3039, which dominated the city, while the light horsemen were to attack from the northwest, while the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade 5.6 kilometers south of Amman sent their 4th Battalion with a demolition squad to destroy the Qusair station, while the 1st and 2nd Battalions attacked Amman from the west. The Imperial Camel Corps Brigade attack was covered by the only artillery, the Hong Kong Mountain Battery. The attack on Amman was launched by the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade from the south, with its right on the railway and its left on the Wadi Amman. On their left, the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade advanced astride the Ain-Es-Sir to Amman Road, with the 2nd Light Horse Brigade on their left. By 11 o'clock, all brigades were engaged, and by midday, the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment was advancing across the Wadi Amman to the railway line near Kissa Station, about 5 kilometres south of the town. A squadron of the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment making their way round to the south of Amman saw a train moving towards Amman, which they galloped to attack, but became bogged within 270 metres of the railway. The damaged section of the railway had been quickly repaired. By 1500 hours, No. 16 New Zealand Company of the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade reached Qusair and destroyed 5 kilometres of culverts. The train steamed into the railway station from the south and the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regimental Headquarters troops opened fire from an adjacent hill. The train quickly departed before a force of friendly Arabs and New Zealanders attacked the station. They captured 6 officers and 42 other ranks, one of whom said the train contained 300 reinforcements for the Amman garrison. The attack by the New Zealanders was pressed to within 550 metres of Hill 3039, where they were stalled when exposed to machine gun fire from both flanks, from Hill 3039 to the south and from the citadel to the north. The citadel was also enfilading the battalions of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade. On the other flank, the 5th Light Horse Regiment escorted New Zealand engineers to a bridge 8 kilometres northeast of Amman and blew an 8 metres hole in it, momentarily isolating the town. On their return from destroying the culverts, Brigadier General Meldrum ordered No. 16 New Zealand Company into the attack on the extreme right of the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade. At about 1800 hours, German and Ottoman units made a strong attack on a ridge between the 1st and 8th squadrons of the Canterbury Mounted Rifles Regiment, but a counterattack by the 10th Squadron drove the attacking units back, and as darkness closely followed, the Light Horse and Mounted Rifles Brigades dug in on the lines they held. During the night, a patrol of 2nd Light Horse Brigade reached the railway line about 11 kilometres north of Amman and blew up a 2-arched bridge spanning a wadi, causing an 8 metres break in the line and isolating Amman from the north. Casualties suffered during the day were 26 killed and 183 wounded. Captures included 54 prisoners. The flying column of 2 British infantry battalions of the 181st Brigade with 3 mountain gun batteries had left Es Salt at dawn on the 27th of March to reinforce the Amman attack, but were delayed near Suwaila by local fighting between 200 and 300 Christians from El Fuhais, Fort Circassians and or Arabs, when about 20 of them were killed. A squadron from the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment negotiated a peace when the Circassians were forced to release prisoners and supply grain for the starving Christians. The flying column bivouacked about 19 kilometres from Es Salt. A company of the 221st Battalion London Regiment was left to garrison Suwaila. A Royal Horse Artillery battery also moved from Es Salt towards Amman with great difficulty, arriving on the last day of battle. Chapter 3, Section 1, Subsection 2, Northern Flank. On the 27th of March, the 1st and 2nd Light Horse Regiments improved their position with an advance despite fire from small groups of Ottoman soldiers north of Ameshshert. In the morning, a squadron established a forward position 2 kilometres north of Ameshshert on the slopes of Red Hill, but was driven back during the night to the ford at Ameshshert by reinforcements. Chapter 3, Section 1, Subsection 3, Aerial Reconnaissance. Reconnaissances on the 27th of March observed that the size of the Hawara camp had trebled and camps along the Wadi Farah had also increased. Ottoman cavalry and infantry with other forces were seen on the Wadi Farah road from Nablus towards the Jisa ed Damier bridge over the Jordan River on the way to Es Salt, and 3 German and Ottoman troop trains were seen to enter Amman from the north and 1 from the south on the same day. Strong bodies of troops were also seen holding hilly positions about Amman and the station. At noon, enemy cavalry at El Qutrani and Kerok were seen preparing to march north when aircraft dropped a bomb in the middle of a cavalry group and then machine gunned the horsemen. Aircraft from the British No. 142 Squadron bombed Amman station and Australian aircraft bombed El Castel station. The German and Ottoman concentration near Nar-e-Zizeka, north of the Es Salt to Amman road, was reported and bombed, and during that afternoon and all next day every air patrol reported enemy cavalry, infantry and transport marching along the Wadi Farah road towards Jisa ed Damier from Nablus on the road to Es Salt. Chapter 3, Section 2, the 28th of March. Chaita's force held a line from the railway near Qusair across the ANS, a track 2 kilometres west of Amman to 2 kilometres northwest of the city. During the night, the German and Ottoman line was strengthened, and soon after daybreak on the 28th of March, German and Ottoman guns opened fire on the Anzac Mounted Division, whose only reply was the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade's 4 12-pounder mountain guns of the Hong Kong and Singapore Mountain Battery. British reinforcements on their way from Es Salt, with two or three batteries of mountain guns began to arrive at 10:30 when the leading battalion was immediately put into a gap in the line, on the left of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, between them and the 2nd Light Horse Brigade. An Ottoman attack on the right was driven off. A general attack was ordered for 1300 hours when two infantry battalions on the left side of the main road with two regiments of the 2nd Light Horse Brigade covering their left flank, the other covering the infantry's right flank, while the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade renewed their attack on Hill 3039. Both attacks supported by three batteries of the 9th Mountain Artillery Brigade. Just before the New Zealanders' attack began, a strong German and Ottoman counterattack fell on the junction between the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade. After getting close enough to throw bombs, the attackers were driven off. The delayed general attack by the mounted troops and the newly arrived infantry reinforcements began at 13:30 but was met by very heavy machine gun fire from all sides. The 221st Battalion, London Regiment, and the 223rd Battalion London Regiment easily covered the first 900 metres, and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, which had advanced 230 metres over a crest and out of sight of supporting artillery with the 6th and 7th Light Horse Regiments advancing, dismounted. They were eventually held up 640 metres from Amman. The ground in front was convex in shape, giving no cover and no forward observation points, while the ground from front and flank was swept by well-placed German and Ottoman machine guns and several field batteries. The New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade was held up by ASIM's German and Ottoman defenders on Hill 3039, which dominated the Mounted Rifles' position and made it difficult to advance, but by 1600 hours, the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment and the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade had managed to advance their line for a distance of 460 metres, to the low ridges at the foot of Hill 3039. Rain was still falling and it was bitterly cold, supply of rations and forage caused some concerns, and darkness found most of the attacking force in much the same positions they had held that morning. Shea ordered the 179th Brigade to take over the defence of Es Salt and ordered the 2nd/22nd Battalion London Regiment, with the 217th Battalion London Regiment and 218th Battalion London Regiment, to advance to reinforce the attack at Amman. Brigadier General Da Costa commanding 181st Brigade and Chater agreed to delay renewing the attack until these reinforcements arrived. Orders were issued for an attack to take place at 2 o'clock on the 30th of March. Chapter 3, Section 3, the 29th of March. Soon after dawn, German and Ottoman artillery began shelling the entrenched, dismounted troopers, British infantry and Arab formations. German and Ottoman forces made several counterattacks, all of which were held and ultimately repulsed, including one on the northern flank between the infantry and the 2nd Light Horse Brigade. However, the overall positions of the opposing forces only changed slightly, while the harsh weather continued with cold rain and cutting wind. Reinforcements were seen arriving in Amman from the north, having marched from the bridge damaged by the New Zealanders. The two remaining infantry battalion of the 181st Brigade and two infantry battalions of the 180th Brigade Division arrived to reinforce the attackers during the day, bringing with them two mountain gun batteries. No more troops could be spared because the threat posed to the northern flank of the attacking forces at Amman by a detachment from the Ottoman 7th Army was so serious that the defenders in the Jordan Valley, the 1st and 2nd Light Horse Regiments, had to be reinforced by an infantry battalion. As darkness fell, a British infantry unit was alerted by a shot from the company's listening post to an enemy attack. Every rifle and machine gun burst out as hard as they could go all along the line, supported by dozens of machine guns tucked away on advantageous slopes behind us, and I pitied Jacko out in that storm. As I banged away with my trusty old rifle, I could see the flashes in the long grass of the Turkish weapons and aimed low accordingly. I fired until my rifle was almost red hot. I had to drop it after about 50 rounds. 29 March 23. There is no material change east of Jordan. Twice our troops, which nearly encircled the town, repulsed attacks, and 8 kilometers of railway track south of Amman station have now been destroyed. Shay informed Chaita that two columns of Hejaz Arabs had volunteered to prevent repairs to the damaged railway line to the north and south of Amman. Chapter 3, Section 3, Subsection 2, Aerial Attack. During 28/29 March, units of Shay's force at Shunet Nimrin were bombed by 13 German aircraft. During the raid, 39 casualties were suffered by troops and the Egyptian Camel Transport Corps personnel. 116 camels were killed and 59 wounded. Chapter 3, Section 3, Subsection 3, Northern Flank. Lines of communication to the forces attacking Amman were seriously threatened by the movement of Ottoman troops from across the Jordan River at Jisa ed Damier, 26 kilometers north of Gornier. Otto Lehmann von Sanders, commanding Yildirim Army Group, had ordered the 7th Army to send reinforcements consisting of 1,800 rifles and swords in some squadrons from the 3rd Cavalry Division with the 145th Regiment, 46th Division. They occupied the height at Kufa Huda on the road to Es Salt after pushing back the 3rd Light Horse Regiment's patrols. In the Jordan Valley, the squadron of the 2nd Light Horse Regiments re-established their position on the slopes of Red Hill. They were followed by the 1st Light Horse Regiment, which advanced 900 meters up the ridge to establish a position which effectively covered the Esh Shirt crossing, allowing horses to water in the river without being fired on. The 220th Battalion London Regiment in reserve at Shunet Nimrin was ordered to reinforce the light horsemen as a significant buildup of Ottoman forces in the area began to threaten their positions. The Jordan River flooded again, and although it was again falling, only one bridge with a long causeway at either end was open for use on the 29th of March, the banks of the others being too boggy for use. Chapter 3, Section 4, the 30th of March. Heavy rain began to fall as the troops took up their positions for the 2 o'clock on the 30th of March. Chaita, the commander of the Anzac Mounted Division, ordered the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the 4th Battalion, Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, to take Hill 3039. He ordered the remainder of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade was to attack along the Ain Essa track directly towards Amman. The 181st Brigade of the 60th Division was to make the main attack on Amman, covered on the extreme left by the depleted and exhausted 2nd Light Horse Brigade, which was to make as great a demonstration as it could. The 218th Battalion London Regiment, less two companies attached to the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade for their attack, were to make the attack on the citadel, while the 222nd London Regiment crossed the main road to enter Amman and advance north of the citadel to the Sail Amman at the eastern end of the town. The 221st Battalion London Regiment and the 223rd Battalion London Regiment were to hold the ground already gained to the north of the city against increasing opposition. The 217th Battalion London Regiment was held in brigade reserve with one company assigned to Chaita as his reserve. Chapter 3, Section 4, Subsection 2, Night Attack on Hill 3039. Without artillery support, Chaita's plan was for an all-out swift and silent night attack on the main objective, Position A. The attacking force would pass along a ridge between B and C positions, leaving sufficient troops to contain these. Once position A was captured, B and C positions would be overlooked and become untenable. Preparations for the attack included officers' patrols from the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment, which reconnoitred the enemy positions, and all units along the front line familiarised themselves with the ground in front of them, over which they would advance in the dark. At 2 o'clock on the 30th of March, the first line consisting of the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment and the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade under the command of Lieutenant Colonel McCarroll began the advance on Hill 3039. The second line of the attack was formed by the Canterbury Mounted Rifles Regiment with two troops of the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment under the command of Lieutenant Colonel Acton Adams. All machine guns were under the command of the officer commanding Machine Gun Squadron, two subsections of which went forward with the attacking force, leaving three subsections in position to cover a retirement if necessary. The first Ottoman trenches were silently attacked and, except for 23 soldiers who surrendered, the garrison was bayoneted, five machine guns were captured. the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment, and the unit of the Imperial Camel Corps Battalion immediately worked to alter the Ottoman trenches and sangars to face the other way while the Canterbury and Wellington Mounted Riflemen advanced through the Aucklanders on their way to attack the second position 270 metres further on. This second position was captured although the defenders were alerted and opened fire with rifles and machine guns when the attackers were only halfway. However, they succeeded in capturing the position, a machine gun and 14 Ottoman soldiers, after which the position was consolidated. Meanwhile, the 16th Company moved up and joined the second line, and with the 8th Squadron Canterbury Mounted Rifles Regiment, they advanced to capture position A overlooking Amman and positions B and C. The defenders of position A were forced to withdraw, and soon after position B fell, one officer, 28 other ranks and 4 machine guns were captured, while position C surrendered without firing a shot. Here 12 other ranks and 1 machine gun were captured. Chapter 3, Section 4, Subsection 3, Night Attack on Amman. The citadel was strategically vital to the western defences of the city, its machine guns denying the possibility of capturing Amman. However, the attack on the citadel by the 218th Battalion London Regiment broke before it got within 900 metres. The Imperial Camel Corps Brigade attacked in 2 waves, 4 companies of the 1st and 2nd Battalions in the 1st and 2 companies of the 218th Battalion London Regiment made up the second wave. However, after capturing the first line of trenches and 28 prisoners, machine gun fire from the citadel stopped further progress on the right. Meanwhile, on the left, fire from the citadel threatened the 222nd Battalion London Regiment, which had exposed its flank after advancing to capture 80 prisoners. They were forced to defend their position across the main road, where they captured 50 prisoners and 2 machine guns during an unsuccessful but fierce counterattack. The infantry captured 135 prisoners and 4 machine guns before 4 o'clock, but afterwards little progress was made, and on the left the 2nd Light Horse Brigade had difficulty holding their line. Allenby reported that at 2 o'clock infantry in the 181st Brigade and the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade attacked Amman, capturing Hill 3039 and 2 lines of trenches southeast of the village. But strong defensive positions covering Amman Railway Station continued to be held in force, making further progress towards the station impossible. At 3 o'clock a British infantry advance in extended order began, several shots rang out slightly to our left, and then instantaneously the ground in front became alive with flashing rifles and machine guns, and hoarse shouts in guttural German and Turkish Arabic added to the increasing excitement. Overrunning the first line of enemy trenches, orders now came to rally, and in a downpour of rain the first and second waves joined up and advanced in the face of a brisk fire from snipers and isolated enemy machine guns across the top of the redoubt. In the distance on all sides could be heard the shouts of the other attacking parties. Most of us saw that unless something drastic was done to dominate the surrounding hilltops well held still by the enemy, though the main portions of the position was already in our hands, we should have to retire or face a murderous fire, the accuracy of which would be made more deadly by daylight. All at once a shell struck the top of the wall immediately above where I was amongst a bunch of number 7 men, and although the explosion made practically no impression, it was obvious if the gun kept steadily on our protection would crumble away in no time and then dash. After some dozen shots, most of which buried themselves in the wall with a thud, the gunners ceased, probably because our Indian mounted battery was beginning to find them. Chapter 3, Section 4, Subsection 4, Daylight Defense of Hill 3039. Before daybreak every effort was made to strengthen the positions won on Hill 3039. Trenches could not be dug in the solid rock, but sangars were built up as high as possible. The New Zealand 16th Company of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade occupied the exposed third position, but after daybreak this proved untenable. Ottoman artillery fire had begun at 5 o'clock and the lack of deep trenches on Hill 3039 was at once felt. The stone sangars, effective enough against rifle and machine gun fire, intensified the shell fire, shrapnel ricocheting in all directions and high explosive shells hurled and broadcast the rocky material. The one-hour bombardment caused many casualties. As soon as it was over, the surviving New Zealand Camel Company troops in the forward position were withdrawn to join their battalion on the right, leaving a post of 10 men with 2 Lewis guns. We had to advance a little and build up small stone sangars about a foot high and lie there all night. Nothing much happened except more rain and more cold and less sleep. All next day we stayed behind the little cover the stones offered and fought a duel with rifles and MGs. We got the hottest fire I'd ever experienced. The lumps of lead sang and buzzed and hissed all day without ceasing. One of my good friends was killed, a sergeant from Rose Bay, and we had other casualties. A Hun put some holes through the shoulder of my overcoat, but did not harm the wearer. They were trying to get round our left, and we had to keep them off. We stopped there again that night, and by this time we were in a pretty bad state as the cold prevented sleep and tucker was running out. After withdrawing from the most exposed positions on the hill, the new front line ran across the top of the hill from east to west and was held by the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, the Wellington, Canterbury, and Auckland Mounted Rifles regiments. By daylight, the advance units on Hill 3039 were being heavily counterattacked by German and Ottoman forces, and between these attacks the hill was shelled by German and Ottoman guns situated to the east of Amman and out of range of the British guns. At about 9 o'clock, a large number of German and Ottoman soldiers could be seen from divisional headquarters massing on the northern slopes. News of this was immediately sent to General Meldrum, but no British artillery was available to fire on the excellent target. At this time, the section of Hong Kong and Singapore Mountain Battery with the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade had only 4 rounds. At 9:30, a determined German and Ottoman attack was countered by effective fire from New Zealand machine guns. Numbers 1 and 3 subsections were in position on the right front of the Canterbury Mounted Rifles Regiment in Sangers, with a good field of fire covering the centre of the position. Number 5 subsection was on the right flank of the Canterbury Regiment, protecting the front of the New Zealand Camel Company. Number 2 subsection was on the left flank of the Auckland Regiment, and number 6 on its right flank, crossing the fire of numbers 1 and 3 subsections. 5 captured machine guns were also in action in the line. However, an unauthorized order to retire was passed along the line held by the 4th Battalion of Imperial Camel Corps Brigade, which caused that battalion, along with the Canterbury and Wellington Mounted Rifles regiments, to start to withdraw. This withdrawal allowed the German and Ottoman attackers to reach the crest, but were held up by rifle and machine gun fire from the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment. Officers on the right quickly saw the seriousness of the situation and succeeded in rallying their men. Captain Hinson and Lieutenants Thorby and Crawford of the New Zealand 16th Camel Company, each in his own part of the line, swept their men back in a charge up onto the crest. The opposing lines briefly faced each other at a bare 14 metres, before the 400 to 500 Germans and Ottomans were forced back, suffering many casualties. During the morning, the extreme left of the old New Zealand line, held by a squadron of the Canterbury Mounted Rifles Regiment, got into the town of Amman, but the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade on their left were forced to retire to their former position. At this time, the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade's Somerset Battery arrived, having overcome all the difficulties in climbing and moving the guns through the adverse terrain, and began firing shell among the enemy. But the battery's arrival was too late to influence the battle. One German or Ottoman battery was put out of action during the operations by the Auckland Mounted Rifles Regiment's machine guns on top of Hill 3039, which forced this forward battery to withdraw from its position near the citadel in front of the Imperial Camel Corps Brigade. But by 1400 hours, 3 German or Ottoman batteries opened a heavy fire on Hill 3039, which continued for the rest of the day, causing many casualties. Great difficulty was experienced in getting the wounded away from the front line, owing to their exposed position and the impossibility of digging communication trenches. At 1600 hours, another very heavy counterattack was made on the New Zealand line, the main force falling on the Camel Battalion, causing them heavy casualties. This attack was repulsed with the help of a troop from the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade Reserve, which prolonged the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade's right to outflank the enemy. The German and Ottoman forces made another attack under cover of an intense bombardment at 1700 hours, but they were again driven back. Chapter 3, Section 4, Subsection 5, Attack on the Citadel. Chaytor ordered his only reserve, one company of the 217th Battalion London Regiment, to support two companies of the 218th Battalion London Regiment along with all the available artillery, to attack the citadel. Although they made some progress, they were stopped by machine gun fire. Chapter 3, Section 5, Summation of Attacks. By the 30th of March, Chaytor's force had pushed infantry in the Ottoman 48th Division back into Amman, but German and Ottoman machine guns positioned on the hills beyond were too strong, and all efforts to dislodge enemy forces failed. The 46th Assault Company had formed Asim's right wing. When Chaytor told Shay of the failure to capture the citadel, Shay asked if there was any possibility of capturing Amman that night. Chaytor replied in the negative. As a result, Shay ordered Chaytor to break off the action. At 17:45, Chetwode, commanding 20 Corps, ordered the withdrawal back across the Jordan River. He took this decision despite the principal objective of destroying the large viaduct at Amman had not been achieved. But it was increasingly less likely that it could be, as Chaytor's force began to have difficulty defending itself from strong German and Ottoman counterattacks. When darkness fell on the 30th of March, the frontline troops received the order to retreat, and an infantryman concluded, "None of us sorry to leave behind forever, we hope, a nightmare of a most terrible nature." Allenby reported to the War Office on the 31st of March that 8 kilometres of railway track and culverts had been destroyed south of Amman station and a bridge blown up, and that the object of the raid had been achieved by cutting the Hejaz railway. It was, in its way, one of the most daring exploits of the war. A weak division, aided by Australian mounted troops, crossed the Jordan and, cut off from the rest of our army, went clean through the Turks for a distance of 40 miles, cut the railway and returned with all their wounded and hundreds of prisoners. Their jumping-off point was 1,000 feet below sea level, the railway was 4,000 feet above them. There were no roads through the mountains and it rained almost the whole time. They got there in 48 hours. When they reached Es Salt, the inhabitants turned out on block to greet them, standing on the roofs of their houses and loosing off rifles into the air. Chapter 3, Section 6, Casualties. Total casualties of both infantry and mounted divisions were between 1,200 and 1,348. The 60th Division suffered 476 infantry casualties, including 347 wounded, and the Anzac Mounted Division suffered 724 casualties, including 551 wounded. Chapter 4, Aftermath. Chapter 4, Section 1, Evacuation of Wounded. The retirement from Amman started with the wounded beginning to be sent back to the Jordan Valley along the main road via Es Salt, despite Es Salt being under attack from German and Ottoman units from the northwest, and after a 2.7 metres flood the only usable bridge was at Gornier. There were over 240 wounded in the divisional collecting stations such as Burke at Umamud, 16.9 kilometres from the front line. All available transport, including sand carts, were employed to get these wounded on their way by the evening, about 50 of them walking. The last convoy of wounded which left Amman at 2300 hours found 20 camels carrying wounded which had begun their journey 6 hours earlier, bogged and exhausted at Suwaila. Nine of them were unable to move and ambulance personnel were left to attend to the wounded throughout the night. By daylight, light horse troopers warned them that the Ottoman cavalry was close. Five camels managed to continue, but the remaining four were too exhausted. Of the eight wounded men, six were placed on horses, but two who appeared to be mortally wounded were left behind when Ottoman cavalry got between the covering party and the ambulance men and began firing on the group. All escaped but the two seriously wounded and three men of the 2nd Light Horse Field Ambulance mounted on donkeys who were taken prisoner. Only one of these men survived the war, the other two dying in captivity. Chapter 4, Section 2, Withdrawal. The front lines were still engaged when the withdrawal began. It was necessary, firstly, to move the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade back from Hill 3039, across the Wadi Amman. They received their orders at 1800 hours to withdraw to the crossroad at the western end of the plateau just above the village of Ain Es Sir. Although the withdrawal by the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade and the 4th Battalion Imperial Camel Corps Brigade was perhaps the most difficult feature of the Operation T was accomplished with great skill and coolness immediately after dusk, the wounded being carried in blankets to the dressing station 2.4 kilometres away. The 2nd Battalion 17th London Regiment covered the withdrawal of the other battalions. All wounded were carried back and as many dead as possible buried. By 2300 hours all wounded had been started on their journey back to the Jordan Valley and the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade commenced to recross the Wadi Amman at midnight, reaching the crossroads at 4 o'clock on the 31st of March. The withdrawal back to the line from which the last attack had been launched was complete by 3 o'clock the 31st of March 1918. The Imperial Camel Corps Brigade began its march back to Ain Es Sir at 4:30. They arrived at 7:15, but the track was too cut up by the passage of camels and horses for the infantry to follow, so Chaytor ordered the infantry to march along the main road to Suvile and then down the Ain Es Sir, where they were met by the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade, which acted as rearguard. Without cavalry the enemy could follow but not pursue. An outpost line was set up across the country between Ain Es Sir and Amman, and the whole day was spent in concentrating Chaytor's and Shi's force, mounted troops, infantry, camels and camel transport, and in getting all camels, both camel brigade and Egyptian camel transport corps down the mountains. The 2nd Light Horse Brigade and the Somerset Battery took the Es Salt Road while the remainder of the force, including the infantry, withdrew by the Wadi Es Sir track, up which the New Zealand Brigade had advanced. All day long and all the next night a long line of weary camels, horses and men slowly stumbled, slipped and fell, down the mountain track which descends some 1,200 metres in 13 kilometres. The camels left Ain Es Sir at 2200 hours on the 31st of March, while the remainder of the 181st Brigade set off at 2 o'clock on the 1st of April in bitter cold and rain, the battalions taking turn to set up rearguard positions. It was well after daylight on the morning of the 1st of April, before the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade, the rearguard was able to start retiring again, while being fully occupied in holding off advanced German and Ottoman troops. Chapter 4, Section 3, Ain Es Sir. As the New Zealand Mounted Rifles Brigade left Ain Es Sir, the last squadron of the Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment was attacked. The 6th Squadron, which had been detached to the 60th Division, rejoined the regiment. German and Ottomans attacks were held off until the regiment filed out from the village. At 7:45 on the 1st of April, as the rearguard squadron of Wellington Mounted Rifles Regiment, the 2nd Squadron, was riding out of the village into the gorge of the Wadi Sir, the squadron was attacked by Circassians, who suddenly opened fire from a mill and adjacent caves, from houses and from behind rocks on the nearby hills. Firing at very close range with a variety of firearms, they wounded men and horses. Horses rearing up, bolted, screaming, joined the numerous riderless horses galloping across the hillsides. Remnants of the 2nd Squadron galloped clear of the village, dismounted and counter-attacked, with the other two squadrons attacking from the ridges above the village. They rushed the mill, and its occupants were killed. No prisoners were taken. The 2nd Squadron suffered 18 casualties, including the squadron commander Major C. Somerville. Chapter 4, Section 4, Return to the Jordan. The 181st Brigade concentrated at Shunet Nimrin at 5:30 on the 2nd of April, by which time the 179th Brigade had reached the Jordan Valley after withdrawing from Es Salt. By the evening of that day the withdrawal across the Jordan River had been completed, leaving bridgeheads at Gournier and Mercadet Hagler, defended briefly by the 180th Brigade defended, which was relieved by the 1st Light Horse Brigade and a regiment of the 2nd Light Horse Brigade.